Although psychology and statistics seem like separate entities, each operating and governing their own land, minding their own business, they're actually intertwined on a fundamental level. The peculiar combination of psychology and statistics is seen in a wide array of areas such as population data, game shows, and the degenerate den down at the local casino. Many of the statistical problems that baffle us and seem counterintuitive do so because of our way of thinking about the problem. Because our psychology is sometimes tricking us into approaching a problem in a not-so-rational way. This video is the first of a 5-part series about psychology and statistics. But just like Black Mirror, they can all be watched independently. Graphs and charts are an absolutely essential part of statistics. They provide a visualization of statistical data so that it's easier for us humans to interpret and understand. Take a look at these data showing the annual chocolate consumption per capita for 10 different countries, as well as their number of Nobel laureates per 100,000 capita. Fairly hard to interpret, right? If you instead plot it on a graph, it's much easier to see if there's any pattern. You could also do the same with daily shark attacks and daily ice cream sales, turning it into this graph. Or perhaps the number of Nicolas Cage movies published in a year and the corresponding number of drowning deaths. But hold on a second. Does that mean that the more movies Nicolas Cage publishes, the more people end up drowning in that same year? This is the basis of the correlation-causation fallacy, and it's a very common way that our psychology tricks us. Just because two factors are correlated does not mean that one of them is causing the other. Let's take a look at the ice cream example once again. Surely shark attacks cannot cause a surge in ice cream sales for that given day, right? There must be an underlying cause. This is what statisticians call a lurking variable, a factor that correlates with both factors but isn't included in the data. In this case, it's temperature. Intuitively, a higher temperature would make more people go to the beach and thus causes a higher chance of both shark attacks and ice cream sales. A lower temperature would make more people stay at home and would therefore give sharks a much lower possibility of attacking and lowering the ice cream sales. The temperature is a lurking variable because it correlates and causes both variables without being included in the original hypothesis. In the example of Nobel laureates and chocolate consumption, we can see that countries like Sweden, Switzerland, Austria, and Norway all have a high chocolate consumption, while also having a lot of Nobel laureates. So it looks like the more chocolate you consume, the more likely you are to win a Nobel Prize. But an underlying factor here could be the fact that the Nobel Prize originates from Sweden and the nearby geographical areas are thus more prone to winning said prizes, in addition to these areas being far less lactose intolerant and thus creating better conditions for the chocolate market. As you might have guessed, chocolate wouldn't necessarily make you more prone to winning a Nobel Prize. For more of these bizarre correlations, I strongly recommend visiting televiking.com. Another way that graphs can seem misleading could be in the way that they're presented. Take this imagined example from a realtor in a German city showing their success in comparison to their competitors. We get the impression that 99.6 Hausen is many times better than Prohausen. More precisely, 7 times better, because we think the size of the bars are proportional to the values. By starting the y-axis at 90, the differences between the companies are exaggerated to make the consumer more prone to believing that 99.6 Hausen is the superior realtor. If we instead started the y-axis at 0, it would look like this, a far less dramatic graph. In another example, Reuters seemingly showed that Florida's new Stand Your Ground law dramatically decreased the numbers of murders committed using guns. But if you look closely, you will actually see that the journalist inverted the y-axis, having 0 at the top. If you flip the graph, it looks much more true to our noble way of reading graphs, and we can see that the result of the new gun law spiked the number of gun-related murders. A third aspect of statistics that often trick our psychology is the difference between the mean and the median. Simply explained, the mean is the sum of all values divided by the number of values, while the median is a number that represents 50% of the values being below this number and 50% being above. So how is that different from each other? Imagine a society consisting of 100 people. 99 of them live in the city and live normal lives and eat normal food. The last guy, meanwhile, Spiders George, lives in his man cave outside the city and really loves eating spiders. In fact, his daily meals consist of 27 spiders every single day, meaning he chomps down approximately 10,000 spiders in a given year. By calculating the mean of the whole population, we find that on average, each person eats about 100 spiders every year, even though 99% never actually eats a spider. This kind of conclusion is what often gives a wrong insight into the state of things. Spiders George is a literal outlier and should not count. A better number to calculate would be the median. Here, we find that the median person, where half the people are above this number and half the people are below this number, eats about 0 spiders every year, and is a much better indicator in this instance. So there you have it. The next time you want to impress your girlfriend by helping her little sister with her math homework, you're all set. A big thanks to Christian Erik Kampmann at Copenhagen Business School for inspiring and helping out with this video.